got fire.
We've got fire.
Well, that's the Snugpak all set up in there. Keep the doors in.
Thanks for joining me on this video, another one. This time I'm heading out to the county of Hampshire. I'm going to meet a good friend of mine who's been in a very fortunate position, and he's managed to acquire himself a piece of woodland, and he's invited me to go and see his woodland and have an overnight camp. I'm riding my Royal Enfield Himalayan, just passed through the village of Liddington, and looking at my sat nav, I've got 41 mile to run, so should be there in about an hour. Beautiful weather for riding, nice and sunny, roads are nice and dry, life is good, I guess you could say. So we're looking forward to this. Also, I've been sent a new stove by Steve from Folding Firebox. He sent me his latest gas wood flame stove, so I thought I'd give that a try as well. And I'm sleeping in my Snugpak Ionosphere bivi, so it's a kind of a woodland bivy camp, if you like. Right, let's get a move on. Not that I'll do that on the Himalayan, mind. I'm now in the peaceful little village of Chilton Foliot, and it was here back in the late 1980s, I suppose it must have been 1980s, where they filmed the Victorian Kitchen Garden, which was a fantastic series if ever you were into that sort of thing. Very nostalgic. This is where the Victorian Kitchen Garden was actually filmed. There's a garden behind there, and that was the garden. And you got this, yeah, I know where I am. It's part of an estate, I think, and then you've got sort of funny estate houses over there. Look at that. Well, I must say, it's been a nice ride out here today. I'm almost here now, about a mile to go. I'm looking for Bullhorn Lane. The piece of woodland's off of a little lane called Bullhorn Lane. This is a lovely piece of woodland, Steve. Three and a half acres?
Three and a half, yeah.
Yeah. And you've just recently acquired it?
Yeah, it was finally signed off back in April, about 25th of April.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
How does it feel then, being a woodland owner?
I feel like the custodian of the woodland, not really the owner, because it's going to be here for hundreds of years, long after I've gone. So yeah. I guess that my children will inherit it. But I can enjoy it for the time that I'm here.
It's a place you can come and just
relax and just experience
peaceful.
Nature, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
It really is lovely.
It is. It's tree bathing, I think they call it. It's supposed to be, or forest bathing, it's supposed to be really good.
Forest bathing, yeah, I've heard that. I've heard that as well, yeah.
Yeah.
Right, well, we're just walking up to the entrance gate now.
Okay, so if you come down here, this is the lowest area in the woodland.
Yeah.
And it's retains its moisture well.
Yeah, yeah. There's not many. Well, I know it's been quite dry. There are a few midges, aren't there? But there's nothing too bad.
No, no. I mean, obviously, this lower area is quite wet in winter.
Have you got any plans for? There's certain things you can and can't do, Steve, isn't there?
Yeah.
You can't cut certain thicknesses of wood down.
No, that's right. I'm not allowed to cut anything that's over 3 inches in diameter down without applying for permission to do it. The only trees you can take down are those that pose a danger if they're sort of leaning.
Yeah. Do you think you'll ever get into woodland crafts? Is that something which interests you?
Getting into?
Woodland crafts.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
I hope so.
Yeah.
I've only been into bushcraft for a couple of years and I've a hell of a lot to learn, but
yeah,
yeah, no, I do hope so.
There's always something to learn, Steve.
Yeah, definitely. I've made my first spoon, but I wouldn't show it to anyone. So one thing that you will notice in here, there's lots of piles of wood. I've not piled them up, but they've just been left there, and I've no intention of doing anything with them.
Cause,
I think they'll help the diversity within the woodland. Probably.
They will. They'll be homes to insects and other critters, won't they? I think you've got a blackbird nesting in there, perhaps.
Probably. Yeah, we've got some. I came down here earlier, and there's a family of ducks down here as well. We've got a small stream along this bank.
Yeah, yeah. So this is also a potential bug out location. Look. So when the shit hits the fan, Steve, you can come here.
Yeah, maybe. So this, you can see over there, there's a pond.
Oh yeah, I see it. Yeah,
a little island in the middle.
Yeah, yeah.
And this stream flows from one pond to another, but at the moment it doesn't seem to be flowing.
No,
we had no rain for.
Did you get a lot of flow during the winter?
Not rapidly. I've only seen it sort of trickling along. How fast it goes, I don't know. But let's say when I came down earlier, there were ducks here, and the extent of the woodland that is up to the middle of the stream.
Right. Okay.
So although the fence is here, I actually own up to the middle of the stream.
You've got a good solid fence as well, haven't you?
In places, it's pretty good repair here, but it's come down in a couple of places, so I need to do some work to get it together.
So the shape of this woodland, Steve, it's like a rectangle, isn't it?
Absolutely,
And it's 3.5 acres, you say?
Yeah, so because it's not quite square, but more or less, so if you're in the middle, yeah, in the middle, you can't really see the edges of the woodland.
So. No, no. So
there's a lot of. I think these are probably deer runs.
Yeah, I should think so. It's a game trail of some sort, isn't it?
Yeah, footprint.
You've spotted muntjac in here, haven't you?
I've heard them. I've not seen them. I saw one of the deer with the white rump.
Roe.
Yeah, I saw one of those on the path when I drove in one day.
What you could try at some point is a game camera or trail camera.
True, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I've heard them barking when I've been staying here overnight. And tawny owls as well.
Lovely. I love how the light is filtering through the trees as well.
Oh, I love it, yeah. It's so much cooler in the shade. I think it's probably about 20 degrees today.
Yeah. Have you got a footpath running through here?
Not through the.
Oh.
No.
There's a path over there and a gate.
Yeah, that's so that I've got access to the stream if I want to. There's not much of a stream, as I say, at the moment.
Some rhododendron bushes. I always find those flowers quite amazing, you know, the...
Yes.
You don't expect to see them in a woodland, do you? But then they are. Then here they are, you know.
And unfortunately, they're classed as an invasive species, yeah. So that's one plant that I can take out without having to apply for permission to do it. And we have got rhododendron on this side. Yeah, so this is the eastern boundary, effectively. It is peaceful. There's a little bit of road noise that you can hear, and given its proximity to London and London's airports, and Blackbush and Farnborough, you do hear aircraft coming over, but that doesn't bother me.
No, no.
A bit of an aviation enthusiast, anyway. One thing I didn't have in here was any wild garlic. So I bought 20 bulbs and I planted those. So
lovely. The only thing you don't want to plant is Spanish bluebells.
Oh, I know. I know. Yeah, we've got them in our garden.
Yeah.
Not me, someone put them in there. But no, I certainly won't be putting any Spanish bluebells
apparently
in.
They can hybridise with the native ones.
They can, yes.
Yeah.
And they have no scent.
No, that's right.
The native ones do.
Yeah.
So yeah, we've got rhododendron here. So I might take out later, I don't know yet.
Yeah.
So this is the southern boundary. And I think a tree must have fallen across the fence
it's
and has
like
taken
it
down there, so I've got to fix that.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's a public footpath that goes along the outside.
Okay.
A lovely looking fern.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, they really are. It must feel nice to have a piece of woodland you can call your own, Steve.
It is. Yeah.
You can see where the rhododendron flowers have fallen.
Yeah.
Made the ground turn.
Quite a shelter spot. If you wanted to camp in here, it wouldn't be a bad spot.
No. It's almost a carpet of purple, isn't it?
Yeah.
I've got a friend on YouTube called Bri. I think he'd like this area. There you go, Bri. What do you think of this? Yeah, it's lovely.
Yeah, last time I came up, it wasn't in flower. It's been a while since I was here.
You've got some nice hazel here, Steve.
Yep. Yeah, I think a lot of the hazel has actually split. I don't know whether that's because deer have been eating the bark.
I reckon so, yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
But it does benefit from being cut back a bit, and it sprouts again. There's a new one there.
I took three pieces earlier so that we can build a tripod for the fire tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know in the past.
Yeah.
If you're just here, this is the remains of someone's little shelter.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, it collapsed a bit.
Yeah.
There were a couple actually.
I think the deciduous woods are always a bit more interesting to shoot compared to the deciduous woods. It's just not variety, you know?
Yeah. Like that bundle.
Steve's new to bushcraft firelighting. He's going to try.
I've never lit a fire using flint and steel. So
right, we're going to record this for posterity. Posterity.
Okay.
I think that's what they call it.
If it works, otherwise we can edit it.
Ooh. No, it took and it went out. You got one, Steve. He's got his ember. Where you want your bird's nest, which is down here. You've got smoke.
Oh, you got fire?
We got fire.
Put your feather sticks on.
Yeah, good idea. And the twig. And we're away.
How's that feel then?
I feel triumphant.
Well, I'm just now going to set up myself set my bivy up. I'll have a look at Steve's setup a bit quick first. He's got it all neat and tidy. It looks like he's got the Snugpak
Stratosphere. Yeah. That's the first time I've used the for the DD tarp.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Be interesting to see how that works.
Yeah, cloud point, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's the Snugpak all set up in there. Keep the doors zipped down, keep any little woodland nasties out. Well, we've got a little oven going, Steve, in there. He's put two little pieces of bannock in small little bacon trays. And that's a 14 centimetre. Zebra billy camo. It's about half an hour later now, and Steve's bannocks, he says, are done. He thinks they're done. Let's have a look at them. Oh, yeah.
Looking good.
Like little loaves of bread, Steve, aren't they?
Yeah. Ow. Oh, that tin's hot.
That'd be hot as well, wouldn't it? Oh yeah, that's definitely done.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
The steak's gone on. What are these steaks then, Steve?
These are ribeye.
Ribeye.
And they've been salted and peppered 24 hours ago. So hopefully they will taste delicious.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Oh, and there's red wine sauce as well. Nice. Is it homemade, is it?
Yeah.
Well, look plenty at
more
that.
There.
You forgot to put the potato on as well, so. Actually, got a baked potato in here. Ah, look at that. I've been well looked after. Bivi. Oh. It's not as practical as a tent. Oh. But once you're in a round day, it's alright. That's it, I'm in. Gonna get my head down and I'll see you in the morning. try and be quiet. Steve's still asleep. So, I hope you're still asleep. I got sent a gift. Very fortunate. Another Steve from Folding Firebox Stove sent me a nano stove and his new gas adapter, a special gas burner with a flame spreader which he calls the Ember plate. This gas burner, you can adjust it so that you have two types of flame. So I'm going to get myself a brew on for a morning brew, and I thought I'd give the stove a try at the same time. This is a carbon pad, so you can place it underneath. Cut out in the metal tin lines up the legs of the stove. That's clever thinking. That's the yellow, that's the wood yellow flame effect that I was mentioning earlier. But I want the, I turn it off, I want the hot flame. So before the stove gets too hot, you can turn the little shield on the stove and get a blue hot flame. Say that's really fast. That's been less than 2 minutes, less than a minute and a half actually. So this acts as a flame spreader, and you can actually use it to toast things or cook steaks on, obviously with a grill above it. It glows bright red. I don't know if you see it in this light. So I'm now using the Ember plate, as Steve calls it, to spread the flame and give me a more even temperature over the pan, and it's working quite well. So Steve's getting his little folding titanium firebox going, and he's going to do the coffee. So this is the first Burley or twig stove then, Steve?
This is it, yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting design. Boundless Voyager it's called, is it? Boundless Voyager?
Boundless Voyager, yeah.
Yeah. Titanium stove. It's not as good as a folding firebox though, Steve.
No, I know. Never could be.
Well, the pot's on, but all the heat, Steve, is coming out the door.
Blame that on the fire starter.
Yeah. Smells good already.
Well, yesterday there were beans. Oh, okay. I ground the beans up, so. And then what you do is put the plunger in. And like a hypodermic, a very large hypodermic.
Yeah.
I think that's it.
Unload it.
Oh, jammed it in there.
That's it.
Just a.
Oh, look at that. Oh, yeah. Proper coffee. Oh, I'm going to get my coffee here at last. Oh, yeah. You can taste that. It's lovely, isn't it?
Yeah.
Cheers, Steve.
Cheers. Yeah, and then on the bottom, you just release the filter.
Oh, right, yeah.
And you get a plug of coffee in the bottom, which you can dispose of. And a filter.
Oh, I see, yeah. Clever stuff, isn't it?
Yeah, so if you push, that can go on the fire. But the coffee plug is comes out as a whole plug when you push the plunger.
Oh, crikey.
And then you're ready for the next one.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
One thing that I've learned about Steve is that he used to be a sailor, and as a result of that, he's pretty good at knots.
Right, so this is quick way to tie a bowline.
Yeah.
So you go round whatever you're tying it to, cross the top and an overhand knot, and then pull on it, and then you've immediately got your bowline.
Oh, crikey, yeah.
That's done. So very quick, very simple. And you can put as much tension on that as you want, and because it's a bowline, you just pull that, and it's undone. So,
that's a nice one, that's
quick,
Steve.
And simple, yeah. Do it again. So once more, over the top, pull it, round, down, and there's the boat.
Anyway, it's time to go. So thanks so much, Steve, for inviting me.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
It's been good having you here, Sandy.
Really enjoyed it, really have. That's thanks great. For the hospitality. Great. I'll be coming back here occasionally throughout the year, maybe sort of 3 or 4 times a year. So you'll see the wood again, you'll see Steve again, and we'll see how it evolves throughout the seasons. So yeah, time to make a move, get on the old Royal Enfield and chug off home. That's it, it's time to go. Thanks, Steve. I'll see you shortly. All the best, Steve. Which way do we go here?
I think it was this way, was it? Have I gone the right way? No, wrong way. Just goes to show how easy it can be to get lost when you come to unfamiliar territory.